It's episode 27 of Covering the Bases. Welcome in to the official podcast of USA Baseball, a celebration of the game's past, present, and future. I'm Daron Vaught. If you haven't yet, you can subscribe on Apple, Spotify, Google, and every episode goes to the USA Baseball YouTube channel as well. So find us wherever you listen to your podcasts, and please share on social media with your friends and fellow baseball lovers. Few players have ever had the kind of five-year stretch to begin a career as our guest, Ryan Howard. From 2005 to 2009, the big piece was NL Rookie of the Year, then MVP the very next year. He was an NLCS MVP, a World Series champion, a two-time Major League home run leader, and he thrice led the league in runs batted in. He made three All-Star games and won the Home Run Derby the very first chance he got. He preceded all of that by playing for USA Baseball's Collegiate National Team in the year 2000, but he's a bit of a renaissance man. He played trombone in high school. He is known for being a very marketable player in his time with the Phillies due to his affable nature, and he's been quite savvy when it's come to endorsement deals and things of the like. He and his wife, Crystal, a former Philadelphia Eagles cheerleader, have co-authored six children's books. I love when these chats can go beyond the game, but there's a lot of good baseball material in here too. So without further ado, here it is, episode 27 of Covering the Bases with former Phillies slugger and Collegiate National Team alum, Ryan Howard. Colin, hit me with the open.
Swing and a miss, and a world championship for the United States.
Arenado on the run. There it is. Team USA has won the World Baseball Classic.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
Your nickname. The big piece. Mm-hmm. Now, Charlie Manuel, I understand, gave you that nickname. What's the origin story behind it?
Oh, I mean, yeah, Charlie gave me the nickname. I don't really know too much about where it came from. I think he just came out of nowhere with it. But when he kind of explained it to me, it was just kind of having that big piece in the lineup, you know, coming up, I guess, in those situations or whatnot. So just kind of being the guy in that lineup that kind of helps move things along, if you will. So just the factor, one of the factors in the lineup. But yeah, when Charlie first kind of came up with it, I was like, a big piece. I was like, what is that? I'm like, I don't really understand. I mean, you can go back to the days of like Negro Leagues where guys like Cool Papa Bell and like, you know, you got guys that got these smooth sound. I'm like, the big piece. I mean, you got the big Hurt, you got Big Poppy. But it's worked and it's fit. And, you know, I love it because, you know, Charlie was always great. Love Charlie. So Charlie came up with the big piece and hey, he came up with it for a reason and it fit.
Yeah. And obviously you guys as a tandem had something working. So in order to not upset that, you know, keep the nickname, however he liked it for sure. Did you have another nickname that was commonly used by teammates prior to that point in your career, maybe in college or wherever?
My friends in high school used to call me like Hurt, like after like the big Hurt,
okay.
Frank Thomas, growing up in St. Louis, him playing over there in Chicago with the White Sox. So they just dropped the big because I wasn't as big as he was, but they used to call me Hurt, you know, just kind of the whole left-handed thing as well.
Yeah.
And then like some of the guys, you know, I guess as they were going through the whole nickname phase, it was, some called me like Big Brown, like big, like UPS, like delivers, you know, just trying to come up with different hits. So it was a couple of different things before big piece kind of stuck.
So coming up with the Phillies, and I think this, in terms of your playing career, probably the best place to start. you were one of just not even a handful of guys to have won the Rookie of the Year and then the MVP in consecutive years. At the time you did it, you joined Cal Ripken Jr. as the only two to do it. And since then, Dustin Pedroia with the Red Sox and Chris Bryant, both of which Team USA alums, I'll add, including yourself. The typical path to the bigs is usually, you know, long and arduous, and you even spent a few years in the minors on your way up, but that was, especially compared to the average, a very quick rise, right? Do you remember thinking about that in those terms at all in those first 2 years, or were you just so locked in that you were just on for the ride and you'll worry about it later?
Oh man, I think it's a little bit of both. In terms of kind of the thought process, because I think it starts obviously before you get to the big leagues. You know, I'm always a big advocate of, you know, the mental side of it, to where it's understanding like, okay, my thought process was like, all right, I've been in the big leagues since I was 15. You know, thinking whatever level I was playing at, I was already there. So that when I actually got to the big leagues, it wasn't anything that was going to be crazy or overwhelming for me. And then once I kind of learned and understood the speed of the game and trusted myself and my ability, you know, it was just, I guess, kind of like, I just felt like it was my time to shine and kind of go out there and just do what I knew I was capable of going out there and doing. And things just kind of fell in the right place and, just kind of went from there. But to the other extent too, it's like, yeah, when you're in it, you're so locked in on being in it to where it's like you don't really take that time to really look and reflect and see what it is that you're doing until after you get out of it. I remember I was telling somebody that the other day, to where it's like, yeah, you don't really take a look at what you've done until you're finished. You know what I mean? So it was one of those things to where, like, while I was in it, while I was doing it, it was, you just want to do more and more and more and more and more, and just try to continue to get better and better. And don't really, it's just like looking at that Rookie of the Year and looking at the MVP years. It's like, okay, yeah, those were good, but I feel like there's more, you know? So you don't want to get necessarily caught up in that, but continue to try to strive to get better and better, and then have that time to reflect after, once you're done.
And part of that includes, I would imagine, the later stages of your career, right? Because you eventually, after those first 2 years in your hot start, became the first to a lot of milestones in terms of games played, right? You were the first to, or the quickest to, I should say. You were the quickest to 100 home runs, the quickest to 200 and 250. I think you were the quickest to 1,000 RBIs in a career as well. At what point did you start to think about those in terms of, and not necessarily getting outside of the moment, because I think as a player, that's your desire, right, is to always stay in the moment. But in terms of, you know, this is the beginnings of me shaping some sort of legacy. And if that's too big of a word, that you don't feel it's that important, you know, it's me leaving my mark on a league, right, and on a franchise. And as you said, something that you had aimed to do since you were a teenager. At what point did that really just start to click, that these things were happening, and you were making a significant mark, or becoming a significant piece, with the pun and the nickname given, of right, Philly's history?
I mean, I guess at the point that it really kind of just stuck was, again, you're locked in on what you're doing, and you're just like, okay, it's kind of like driving down a highway, I guess, and you see a sign, and you know the sign is there. It says, you know, gas 2 miles or whatever. If you see it, and it's like, oh, okay, that's cool, but you continue to just stay focused on what you're doing and just continue to drive and just drive past that sign. So it's kind of like with those, to me, it was like, oh, like you're the quickest to this, or you're the quickest to that. It was like, all right, yeah, that's cool. But at that time, you're so locked in on what you're doing. Again, it's wanting more and more and more, and it continued to just try to get better, 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 that, you know, I didn't really realize what was going on until after I was done, you know, to do what I did and my first couple of years and you know, and being the fastest to 100, 200, 250, I think it was second fastest to 300 homers. You know, to do that, like, yeah, it was looking back at it now. It's like, man, that's pretty amazing.
I like your analogy there. My friends give me a hard time because I'm good at many things, great at few things, Ryan, but I am probably historically bad at directions and being like that navigationally challenged. So it could be a trip to the grocery store. Likelihood is I'm pulling it up on maps on my phone. So that resonates with me in a way that, you know, I'm not seeing signs. I'm seeing whatever my phone is telling me. And if the phone is telling me the greater goal of whatever it is, get to John's house prior to whatever time, then that's what I'm worried about. And I'm not going to notice much in the meantime. So I that resonates with me for sure.
Right. Right.
You also in that 2006 season participated in your first All-Star game, which I want to talk about. That was in Pittsburgh. And as part of that weekend, you won the Home Run Derby. You did, I'm telling you, Ryan, in those first 2 years of your career, more than most guys get in a decade of playing at the major league level. To be a home run hitter and someone who, I don't know if you really focused a lot on being a power hitter, right? Was home runs something that you wanted to put into your game as more than it was just something that was there when you played your style? But what was that like as a home run hitter? Just your second year in the bigs. Obviously, at that point, there were talks of you being an MVP candidate. I can't imagine how fun that must have been.
Yeah, I mean, the drive was always to try to be the best version of myself, to be the best, you know, best I could be and be the best in the game. And just going out with my approach was really just making contact. And if it lands over the fence, it lands over the fence, but just trying to have a good approach. I always knew that I had power. I didn't necessarily try to go up and go hit home runs. It just, you know, wound up happening that way. But, you know, I always just try to kind of stay focused on my approach and driving runs and just be the best version of myself and to ultimately try to be the best player in the game. And it worked out, you know, 06, whatnot. And, you know, really it was just about winning games and just driving in runs and just being the best version that I could be to try to help my team, you know, win as many games as we possibly could.
So, All-Star weekend. Again, this is a very fast rise in your first couple of years in the league. And I know the very first stint you had the September call up. So technically it was your third year in the bigs, but your second full season, you make the All-Star game, murmurs of you being an MVP candidate, and you go to Pittsburgh and you're in the same locker room as countless other guys that I'm sure over the handful of years prior to that you looked at saying, I want to be where they are. Walk me through just the emotions of making your first All-Star game.
Oh man, it was so much fun. And I got to pick my son who was 5 at the time and took him over with me and just really just being able to like soak it all in. I mean, this is stuff that you grew up as a kid watching the home run derbies, watching the All-Star games, watching your idols in there. And now you're playing alongside of these guys, number one, during the regular season. But now, you know, being in the locker room with some of them and in an All-Star game, I mean, it's kind of like the creme de la creme at that point in the season of guys that are going out there and playing. And, you know, for me, I was like, I just want to soak this entire thing in and just have as much fun as I possibly could. Got out in the home run derby. It was funny because I don't hit home runs. Like I never hit home runs in batting practice during the season. And everybody was kind of worried. They were like, oh, dude, like, are you going to be okay in this home run derby? And I was like, yeah, man, I've done a couple in the past, and I actually did one for Team USA, back in 2000 in, the Cape Cod League. I remember it was myself, Mark Teixeira, and it was a couple of guys, I think like Todd Linden, and a couple other guys from, the Cape squad. And I think Xavier Nady was in it as well. So I wound up winning that one. It wasn't very, it was like 2-1, I think, or something like that in like the final or whatnot, but we were playing in Chatham. So that was a lot of fun. So I had some experience being in home run derby, before. So I knew when, you know, if I had to dial it up, I could, but it was just funny because everyone was kind of wondering, hey, are you going to be able to do this? Because you don't really hit home runs in batting practice and stuff. So, so I just, you know, I knew, hey, I knew what I needed to do. And I think like the competitive juices just kind of kicked in, but it was even more so looking to have some fun, with doing it in the first place. So I just went in there to go have fun the entire time. And then all of a sudden, like, I guess the competitive juices just kind of kick in and you just go from there.
I remember that one pretty distinctly. You beating David Wright in the finals of it. And that was one of the first iterations of them doing it sort of round by round like that.
Mm-hmm.
But you, I think, barely made it through the first round in that, right? Like,
yeah,
maybe by
so.
by like a single home run, and that kept you hanging on. And then you come out in round two and blow everybody away. That just seems to me like, if you are the type of player that can put yourself in that position to compete in the home run derby, that's got to be one of the most fun things ever. Do you recall maybe just reactions? Because one of the best parts of All-Star Weekend too, and all of those festivities, is you got everybody and their families are just like chilling out in foul territory for that and watching. Right. Did you have a contingency, like certain people that were in your corner and hyping you up in between rounds?
I had my son with me. I think my brother was there as well. So yeah, no, he was down. My son was definitely down on the field with me. You know, he was helping me out. He would kiss my bat and like kind of give it good luck and, you know, do all that good stuff. And, so yeah, it was funny because I forget who it was, that was hitting, and like he had some of his teammates had gone up to him and like towed him down. And I remember Robinson Cano came over to me and say, Howie, hey, here's what we're going to do, bro. He said, hey, after you hit, you know, whatever home run or you take your time out, like we're going to come up and we're going to towel you down and give you, you know, the Gatorade and all that kind of stuff. I was like, all right, cool, bro.
Nice.
So,
yep.
And it was cool doing that with Robinson because we kind of came up in the minor leagues together, where obviously he was in the Yankees system, but we played against each other pretty much at like every level.
Yeah.
From, I want to say from low A all the way up through to the big league. So, it was pretty cool to be able to have that moment and just kind of goof around a little bit during the derby.
And as far as the entire weekend, like the All-Star game is concerned, was there anybody when you walked into that clubhouse that maybe walked up to you as the younger guy? I know for a fact you had to be one of the youngest guys in the NL locker room at that time. Did anybody in particular walk up and just kind of like welcome you in? Anything that sticks out?
Not too much. I mean, I think all the guys that were there pretty much did. A funny story though, back on the home run derby front.
Yeah.
Lance Berkman. So they call everybody over, all the participants for the derby. And, you know, they're kind of going over the rules, the game plan, the whole nine or whatever. And Lance, I guess, had been in one before. And Lance said, hey, guys, just a quick thing, too, is like you don't want to go up there and just go swing at every single pitch. Like, you know, kind of do this, that, and the other, you know, kind of take a time, make sure, blah, blah, blah. Lance goes up and swings at the first five pitches. So we're like, wait, didn't he just tell us not to go up there and go swing at the first five? But that was cool. But all those guys, I mean, like Lance Berkman, who else was on that squad? There's so many guys, that were on there that everybody came up and said, hey, congrats, keep doing what you're doing. You know, even the guys from, the American League, when you get out there, it's just all fun. It's just all love. So, everybody's congratulating all the young guys. And, it was amazing.
That's really cool. So we haven't gotten into, we've been talking about your Philadelphia days. We haven't gotten into the two World Series that you played in. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would imagine, knowing Philadelphia as the sports town that I know it as, that had to be just like the thrill of a lifetime, because as tough as they can be on their professional athletes, winning in Philadelphia is maybe as rewarding, I would have to imagine, as winning anywhere in professional sports, right?
Right. Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, it was definitely a town that was starved for a championship, no matter what kind of championship it was. Definitely one of the biggest things and biggest moments you could ever be a part of is just the electricity that you could feel. I mean, I remember we won out in LA. We clinched to go to the World Series, and we heard all the stories about what was going on back in Philly. And people were climbing street lights, and everybody's just going crazy. And we're like, man, we didn't even win yet. I mean, we just got to the World Series, but I mean, it was just kind of the foreshadowing of what would be if we were to win the whole thing, because this, the town has been starving since I think the last championship was like 1983.
Yeah.
So, it's one of those things to where being a part of that, and that's what you play the game for though. You know, is to compete and try to win championships, and you play to win the game, as Herm Edwards said. So I mean, to be able to be a part of something like that and just the love, I'll still walk around Philly today and people are like, oh man, thank you so much, Rye. Like, we appreciate you, and we appreciate the championship, and it's because people understand that stuff's not guaranteed. So, you take them when you can get them, and I think everybody was much appreciative.
This might apply to those World Series teams, but you can pull from somewhere else if you'd like. Who's your favorite big league teammate you've ever had?
Favorite big league teammate I ever had. Let me see. Man, I was cool with everybody.
Hard for me to imagine that you weren't cool with everybody, but so maybe that makes this a tough question.
It's tough. I mean, because everybody was cool in different ways. I mean, because I can go back to some USA guys too. On the Phillies, I would say obviously Jimmy Rollins, Shane Victorino. Were guys, Shane and I were roommates in AAA. Jimmy took me in when I first came into the league. And then, man, just the guys I remember, like Chris Burke was cool. Mm-hmm. Who else, man? Those guys would probably be the guys I would say. Raul Ibanez, love Raul, man. That guy's hilarious. Jason Worth. So it's hard to try to pick just one because everybody was cool in their own facet.
And on a championship team, I mean, if it's a large group of guys that accomplish the one goal that you go and set to accomplish, I mean, it's hard to not be cool with everybody there, right? I mean, in such an ensemble where everything's working for sure. Maybe this one's a little bit easier for you, just sort of a look back. You had a lot of teammates, so it's tough to pick a favorite teammate. You had 383 career home runs in the bigs. Do you have a favorite or most memorable home run?
Oh, wow. I would probably have to say my first home run.
Okay.
I mean, because, I mean, it might be cliche, but it's like, obviously, it's the one, you know, that led to all the rest. So, you know, it's basically kind of that arrival moment where it's like, oh man, you know, at least I could say I hit a home run in the big leagues, you know? So, I would probably have to put that one out there.
And what are the details of that one? Do you remember?
Yeah, that one was at Shea Stadium. My call up year 04, September 04. I think it was it September. It might have been September 11th, 04. Or I forget exactly. I think it was one of those two. It was either the 9th or the 11th. And I remember hitting it. I came in, I pinch hit, and I was pinch hitting for the pitcher, and I got it, and I hit it. And I was like, oh, yeah, that felt good. Like, I hit a bunch of home runs in AA that year. So I was like, oh, I know what a home run feels like. So, but then I see Mike Cameron playing center field for the Mets, and he starts running, and all of a sudden I was like, wait, hold up, time out. Did I not get that? Does the ball carry different in the big leagues, or did I miss something? And he ran to the fence and jumped up on the fence, and I was like, come on, man, no way. And it landed probably about 15, 20 feet. Back then, like right center, there was a batting cage, or a net or something out in like right center field.
Yeah. Okay.
And landed on top of that net. So it was a lot further away than what it seemed. But I was like, man, like that's crazy that he kept running after that. Cause I thought he was going to catch it, and I touched home, and Jimmy was waiting in the on deck circle. He's like, congrats, big man. I was like, hey man, did you see that? I thought he was going to catch it. He's like, no, man, that ball was crushed. He's like, so, you know, so it was one of those things to where I'm like, man, you know, he fooled me on it. He fooled me. So, but yeah, I mean, to have that as my first big league home run, kind of get scared too at the same time that it wasn't going to be, was something special. So, and having it be against the rival, the Mets, I mean, you can't go wrong with that.
For sure. And confirmed, I looked it up while you were giving me that answer, September 11th, 2004. So your memory does not fail you.
Yeah. Gotcha.
I would imagine during a September call-up to have a moment like that too, mm-hmm. Were you worried at all that in your mind it was like, oh, that maybe it really is a different game up here? And you know what I mean? Like, hey, I feel like I crushed that. Everyone else seems to think that I crushed it, but it wasn't that far out. This is going to be tougher at this level than I thought it was going to be. Did that creep into your mind?
Not really. Cause I really just believed in my ability and knew what I was capable of doing. So to me, it was just like, okay, now I get it. And didn't really understand the depth of how far the ball had really traveled.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was just Cameron scaring me on it, but,
and the type of fielder he was, he had a chance to catch, you know, just anything out there anyway. So like good on him to play it through.
Oh no. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing for me was just understanding the speed of the game. Because at each level, the game gets faster and faster. So for me, it was about slowing the game down and just letting it kind of come to me in a sense. Which is what I, you know, just really just tried to do to the best of my ability. So yeah, once I did that, I felt like I was in a good spot.
One of the most popular items on USABaseballShop.com has returned. Load up with the Nike Brasilia backpack, available in both navy and gray. It's the perfect bag, ideal for packing everything you need to get through a full day of training when you're away from your locker, gym, or home. It's the Nike Brasilia backpack, and it's available once again at USABaseballShop.com. Plus, pro tip for you here. With free ground shipping on orders over $75, you can grab something else from the new arrivals and have it all sent your way for nothing. That's at usabaseballshop.com. Now back to Ryan Howard. So, given that this is the USA Baseball podcast, I want to get to your collegiate national team experience, which you've referenced a couple of times so far. Yeah. But first, let's talk about your involvement with Diamond Kinetics, which is a partner of USA Baseball. And together, the two have worked together on a lot of things, including launching the Play at Home initiative. It's 38 instructional drill videos for staying sharp with less access to fields and all the usual resources that were taken away as part of the COVID-19 pandemic shutdowns. They're all available on the USA Baseball mobile coach app and at usabdevelops.com. You can also learn more at diamondkinetics.com. Now, Ryan, we use with USA Baseball evaluations and assessment events a lot of what Diamond Kinetics has to offer, including our national team identification series, which has a testing day. And, you know, you gain measurables for players like barrel speed for batters, spin rate, spin direction, release velocity for pitchers, things like that. It intrigues me to talk with guys who have played out full, you know, entire big league careers about these sorts of things. How have you seen technology within the sport change since the beginning of your career?
I think that's pretty self-evident that, you know, we didn't necessarily have all of that stuff. The approaches and everything were a lot different when I was coming up, even as a kid. So, I mean, I think at best as a kid, I had the baseball that had the miles per hour on it. When you would throw it, you got about 7 or 8 good throws out of it. And then all of a sudden it was just done for after that. I think with the way that technology has kind of come, I think towards the end of my career, you know, you felt like, this might be used as a hindrance. Like this could be used as, you know, something against me because you're trying to get these measurables. But now it's like, it's when you look at it, there really is a good benefit to it because it's all about trying to maximize performance and understanding what somebody can do. And to me, ultimately, if it's something that you can take and you can get better from using it, right? As opposed to just having a piece of equipment that tells you, hey, this is how hard you swing. This is how hard you throw. This is that. This, how do you use that information to help make yourself better? Right. So when you can differentiate and do that is where I think there's the huge value add in that. And I think like with the stuff with Diamond Kinetics, I think that's there because obviously with the balls, pitchers can understand because you can kind of create another pitch to where if you're working on a slider or a cutter or, you know, whatever that pitch might be, you've got an opportunity of saying, okay, well, if I slide my fingers over a little bit more on the seams, I get this kind of rotation. And so if I move them this way, I may get a little less. So you've just kind of created, you know, two variations of the same pitch to where if you want to throw the one with less, to kind of get a little bit of a chase or something or a show me and then throw the hard one, the good one, I guess. Like now you've just created two variations of the same pitch. So in that aspect, I think you definitely get better using the technology. I remember being down, at the camp that they had and one of the pitchers was holding the ball and we were just kind of talking about it and he just thought it was amazing to be able to get that kind of detail and get that kind of information back and was excited about using the equipment. Cause, you know, had we had that kind of stuff, I think early on, again, it's when you get the true understanding of what all the metrics and all the data is used for, then it's like, oh, okay, that's actually more so for a benefit and not a detriment.
So in your prime, what kinds of metrics did you have access to with the Phillies and did you pay attention to any of them right there in the heart of your career?
We didn't really have access to a whole bunch of stuff. I mean, I think for us, the game was really just simplified to just, you know, hey, go out there, pretty much kind of see ball, hit ball, but, but that's just, again, how we were all kind of raised and how we were brought up playing baseball from being kids.
Yeah.
You know, you were coach taught for the most part. So, so it becomes a different type of situation when now all of a sudden you start introducing, all the new technology that's out there and allowing it to come in and really kind of help enhance these guys' game.
Well, let's get to 2000, Collegiate National Team. It was your first experience with Team USA. You were on this squad with Mark Teixeira, Chris Burke, who you've mentioned, Xavier Nady, you talked about as well. Mark Pryor, Kirk Sarlous were some of the pitchers on the squad. What were your expectations walking in to play with that team for the first time?
Well, first off, I was like, man, this is a squad that we've got here. Pryor, I remember I'd actually gone in 99, my freshman year first, and unfortunately didn't make the squad that year, and then came back again in 2000. And the reason why I bring that up is because Mark Pryor was there also in 99. And I think that's when he was at Vanderbilt his first year. Mm-hmm. And then the next year at the tryouts, had been at USC. And I was like, yo, this is the same dude from last year. 'Cause it was night and day. The way that Mark Pryor had just changed, from when he was at Vanderbilt to SC. So, you know, I knew we had some guys. We had my man, Debo Dewan Brazelton.
Yeah.
On there as well.
Middle Tennessee, right? He was a big deal as a prospect.
Yeah. I don't know if we faced him when we were there. When I was at the time, Southwest Missouri State, now Missouri State, but I know we faced Middle Tennessee, but I don't know if he pitched against us. I forget. Who else? Oh, my roommate, Jake Gotro, who's the hitting coach now at Mississippi State. You know, both of us, I remember kind of waiting to find out, like, if we were going to make the team, because the coaches, Mike Gillespie, I think from SC at the time, was the head coach. And I think we didn't find out until about 2 or 3 in the morning. They called us in and told us that we made the team. So we're like, wait, do you think maybe they called the guys that didn't make the team and we made it or what? Like, what do you think it is?
Right. What took so long?
Yeah. But I mean, going into that team, man, I knew there was a lot of talent on there. Everybody was pretty much predicted to be, you know, first to third rounders in the draft coming up the next year. So yeah, I was excited for the opportunity.
Did you go in with maybe a chip on your shoulder? And you had won, I think, conference freshman of the year prior, when you talk about going in as a freshman. Coming from a smaller school than some of these SEC guys or mm-hmm. West Coast guys, did you go in with a chip on your shoulder trying to prove that, you know, was it important to prove that you belonged with those guys and in those same conversations?
I mean, I think you have to, in a sense, because, you know, people look and I, you know, not to knock the situation, but I felt like the first year in 99, I felt like I didn't make it because I came from a smaller school. There were a lot of guys there from, you know, at the time it was Pac-10, now Pac-12. Pac-12 schools or bigger name schools and stuff like that. And I actually felt I had a better, tryout in 99 than I did in 2000. So I think, yeah, when you do come from a little bit of a smaller school, it's, you do have to come and kind of try to open some eyes, because those coaches know, you know, from their conference and usually just kind of where like a lot of that talent lies, you've got to come and come correct, I guess.
Yeah. And That was all pre National Training Complex in Cary. Yeah. So you guys did the majority of your training. What would probably in Arizona, I think for.
Yeah, that was, yeah. High Corbett. Yeah. The old Rockies, the old Rockies training facility out there. Yeah.
Yeah. So you guys, played that summer a little bit of everywhere. It was cool looking through the schedule here. You went to Hawaii. You played out west, up into the Northeast, playing the Cape team and some others like you referred to. And then you guys went to Amsterdam as the international travel component. That had to be really cool. Had you at that point, 20 years old, maybe 21, had you done a lot of international travel to that point in your life?
No. I mean, I think the only other place I'd ever been at that point was like really, I'd been down to the Dominican when I was like 11, 12, 13, to play. But other than that, that was like my first real, you know, international cross the waters type of trip. So I thoroughly enjoyed that, heading out there and just being able to kind of, you know, learn about the culture out there and just being able to go out and play some ball out there.
And that was cool too, because it's not like you went to the Netherlands solely to play the Netherlands. This was a large tournament. You guys played Chinese Taipei, Italy, Japan, Cuba. Netherlands was in on it, of course. Were these your earliest impressions of international baseball cultures, like stylistically? And obviously after a career in the bigs, you saw a little bit of everything, right? Because guys from everywhere play in Major League Baseball. But I always find it interesting that at this age, a lot of guys who have only played, you know, big time high school baseball in the United States and been in whatever conference that they're in collegiately, haven't really been exposed a ton when they see Chinese Taipei and they're playing this little slap, small ball style of offense. And the pitchers are a little bit more deliberate and they throw not as hard typically, that sort of thing. What were your early impressions of how other countries played the game?
It was interesting to see the different styles. I think, as you mentioned, you know, a Chinese Taipei would differ slightly from that of like a Japan, where Japan seemed very buttoned up, very, very rigid, very regimented type, very, very like fundamentally sound, in their play, where like a Cuba, you know, it was a little bit of flash and just, you know, it was all different kind of aspects of play. So, I mean, Cuba was like a little bit loose. It was almost kind of, for lack of a better term, it could be like some sandlot ball.
Yeah.
You know, to where it was like guys would come up there. And, you know, they were swinging, they make contact, they'll hit it a mile, but then, you know, there's a possibility they strike out. So, it was interesting to kind of see all those different facets, because I kind of felt like, yeah, I mean, USA baseball is kind of in the middle, you know, like we're more, yeah, you're going to be more fundamentally sound, but I felt like Japan would be just boom, like super tight. You know, in terms of how they would go about their fundamentals and doing all the stuff that they would do. And I mean, obviously for us, you know, hitting home runs and stuff is kind of the big thing. But, you know, there in Chinese Taipei and Japan and Korea, it was like, you know, the small ball kind of reigned supreme. And we would do small ball when small ball was necessary. But like for the most part, it's like you're trying to, you know, appeal and win the game, but also, hey, you're trying to do some stuff for your scouts out there as well.
Yeah. Yep. For sure. And for the record, you guys dominated that summer. you went your last month of play without losing a game. There was a game after 12 innings. They called it a tie in Chatham. But other than that, I mean, you guys went crazy. 27-3-1 on the summer, including that tie. What sticks out about... Obviously, that's an environment where you're playing with some of the best competition you've ever played with at that point in your career. Things that you learned about your game, about others' game, that games that can help you with yours. What all came to focus for you that summer?
I mean, first off, being on a team like that, where you just had so much talent, I mean, obviously, that starts like at the top of the lineup, and that goes back to Chris Burke. And I was like, man, I've never played with a leadoff guy like this guy. To where if Berkey got on, I think it was like Chris Burke and like Richard Lewis was the shortstop, second baseman or shortstop. I think Richard went to like Georgia Tech. Berkey was from like Tennessee, and like when those two got on, when Berkey got on, I mean, he would pick up their signs, like steal their signs and then like relay them or whatnot. But, you know, again, Berkey was one of those guys where it wasn't if, it was what pitch. So if he got on, it was automatically a double because he was going to steal second base and then, you know, just put us in a position to be able to, get up early in the games. But I mean, I think just being around the kind of talent that was there, it was like, yeah, it just made you want to raise your level of play. For me, you know, when I got to play, it was just going out and trying to make the most of it. You know, enjoying the opportunity, but at the same time, trying to just continue to grow, work on different facets, of my game defensively, tried to continually get better. You know, as well as offensively, you know, just working on different things, working on approach and things of that sort.
I need to go back. I wanted to and realized I just skipped over it in my mind. Ask about the moment at 2 a.m. when you and Gotro collectively, I think, figured out that you guys had made the team. What was the reaction when you found that out? Because look, anybody's career is made up of small victories, right? Small triumphs. And it's just a collection of those. And in some cases, it's a small triumph despite something. In most cases it is, or it's not a comeback necessarily, but it's after failing being part of the process, conquering it and then making the team, as in your case, not in 99, but in 2000. What were your emotions when you found out that you made the team?
Well, both of us were tired because it was 2 a.m, but you know, but we were both excited because they called us both in at the same time. I think we were like the last two guys that they had called in to let know. But I mean, we were definitely excited because I remember, you know, they had the conversation and said, hey, we would like, you know, you to both be on the team. And I remember because Tex, Teixeira was playing third and Goat was from Tulane, went to Tulane and played third there. And it was, one of those situations to where they were like, oh yeah, you know, we'll split time between Gotro and Teixeira at third, but also have Gotro come and play, you know, split some time at first. And they were like, so you guys will get, you know, pretty good amount of playing time. And I was like, all right, that's cool. So, you know, then they were like, all right, well, we got pictures at eight in the morning or something like that. So we didn't have too much time to like, you know, go in and really get rest because we had to go back and like, you know, get basically like a power nap and wake up and get ready to go do like team photos and all that kind of stuff.
And what was the camaraderie like off the field doing all that traveling. I mean, there's not a ton of downtime, I know, because I've right. gone around with the Collegiate National Team the past couple of years on certain trips, but there's at least a little bit of downtime, and you guys have to eat mm-hmm. at some point, things like that. Right. Did you have a lot of opportunities?
Yeah, there was some good. Yeah, there was some good camaraderie. There was some good some times in all the different spots. You know, different guys and different groups would kind of go out in different places or whatever. I mean, obviously, like Hawaii, you know, there was groups of us that would go out and go, like, you know, roam around the city. I remember a bunch of us, like, rented scooters and just did, like, and just drove around. I don't even know if we didn't even know where we were going. We just got scooters and just were driving around, you know, on scooters in the city. I remember, you know, hitting the beaches and whatnot in Amsterdam. I remember Duan and I went. And then a couple other guys had also gone, you know, and just tried to get out and take in as much of the sights as we could. You know, there was the times there were more guys than, and then there were less guys. So, the group itself, was a pretty fun group.
I want to finish with something, a couple things that are a little off the board. I happen to be a huge fan of the TV show The Office, and you made an appearance on that show. And if I'm not mistaken, Ryan, the show made its debut when you were playing in the minors in Scranton. Mm-hmm. I've got a couple of questions regarding this. A, are you a fan of the show given your kismet paths crossing with both Scranton and you appearing on the show, and how did that come together?
Yes, I am a fan of the show. And then I don't know. I remember just playing in Scranton, and somebody had told me, you know, this was like 2004, 2005. Because I started back out in Scranton to begin the season in 2005, and I just remember somebody was telling me that, yeah, there's like this show, like it's called The Office. It's like, it's supposedly based out of Scranton. Cause at that time I had never heard of it. Like I didn't watch it then. And so they were like, yeah, there's like this character. There's like a Ryan Howard character on there. I was like, oh, really? I was like, that's crazy, man. And like still hadn't watched it or anything. So, you know, I didn't know if that was something like based off of me, or if that was just, you know, just total coincidence that they had named, you know, the character Ryan Howard. But I thought it was pretty cool either way, because I was like, I can play it off either way. So I was like, oh yeah, they totally named the guy after me. What do you think? I played in Scranton. What? It's the logic, right? But I didn't know. But you know, once I got the opportunity, I think as they were kind of coming down to their final season, I think it was kind of having some stuff either looked kind of come full circle and having me have the opportunity to get on there. And I was like, I can't pass this up. So, yeah, it was perfect. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
So I got to know, because, we have some listeners who might not be familiar with the show. Ryan mm-hmm. Howard is a character portrayed by a guy named BJ Novak, who is, yes. you know, he is a scrawny, squirrely white guy. and visually speaking, could not be further from Ryan right. Howard, Philly's first baseman. What were your first thoughts when you maybe tuned in after finding out that this was the show? And then it's like, oh, that's Ryan Howard.
Right. I was like, oh, that's interesting. But, you know,
you're like, okay, so it's not me.
Right. Cause I was like, okay, I got it. Well, at least my name's out there. But, you know, it didn't really look too much into it. I thought it was still cool though. Cause again, I didn't know if that was something that was like loosely based or what it was really based on, if that was just the character. But, you know, all in all, I still thought it was cool.
For the record, one of my favorite moments in the entire series is when they're in New York and the character Ryan Howard, again, looks nothing like our guest Ryan Howard, tries to get into a club in New York, and he's giving someone who evidently has a list his name. And he says, Ryan Howard, and he pauses for a second, the baseball player, because he's desperate to get in. A great moment.
Oh, it's hilarious.
Yeah, yeah. So you made TV appearances in like Always Sunny in Philadelphia, Entourage as well. Is that something that you ever envisioned doing, is having these cameo appearances and being a small part here and there of pop culture?
Yeah, I would say so. I always enjoy kind of doing a little, you know, some things that are outside the box, and kind of enjoy seeing other people in their element and watching them perform in their element. So like doing all the stuff with It's Always Sunny and Office, you know, working with those guys was amazing. Like Entourage was a little bit different because I was basically with my brother, and we were shooting it in the backyard of my house in Philly, like at the pool. And it was the phone call to Turtle, when Turtle was trying to get investors for Avion tequila.
Yeah. Okay. And, yep. So that's not really you being on set.
Yeah. So I didn't really have like the face to face interaction from Entourage, which is why, you know, it was a little bit different, but it was still cool and all, because it's so cool to be able to see all the behind the scenes stuff that takes place. And all the work that goes into, you know, putting something together for like a 30-minute show or a 30-minute clip or whatever, you know what I mean? So yeah. It's always very cool and interesting. And I get, very entertained by seeing the process for all that.
Did anything surprise you about that process from either show? I know The Office the best, so that's the one where you're in the it's the sports marketing firm with Jim and Daryl, you know, John Krasinski and Craig Robinson. Did anything about the process of making a TV show surprise you?
You know what, I would say the biggest thing would be, I mean, obviously, like, you have scripts, but then when you have shows like that and you get an understanding for how, you know, actors do their thing, to where, like, when they let you freestyle and it's like basically anything goes, you know, and see how things come together, because they're like, you know, I forget what movie it was. Because a movie that Jim Carrey did, I think it was, somebody was saying it was like Dumb and Dumber, where they were like, yo, just keep the camera rolling. And
yeah.
The clips that they got were more of them messing around and doing stuff that wasn't necessarily scripted, but, you know, fell into what it was that they were looking to do and actually came out better that way. So when we did It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, you know, the guys were doing the wrestling scene and the drinking scene. And it was just funny because like that whole thing was basically freestyle, to where they told me and Chase to, you know, hey, you know, say your lines however you would normally speak and say them. And, you know, we're trying not to laugh like off screen, but, you know, but it's cool to see like how much of that stuff is just, you know, them just kind of ad-libbing or doing whatever. And then obviously it's knowing your colleagues, right? Same way on a baseball field, to where if you're a shortstop and a second baseman, when you know what the other one is going to do, you know where to be, you know what I mean? To kind of help correspond in terms of trying to make a play together. I think it's very similar when it comes to the acting portion with the actors and watching them in their element.
Yeah, that's a cool comparison. And cool experiences, I'm sure. One last thing, again, something that's a little bit off the board. You and your wife, Crystal, have co-authored 6 children's books. Speaking of doing things that are a little bit outside your element or getting into a variety of things, and Scholastic has picked up these books. It's the Little Rhino series. What led to you and Crystal getting into this in the first place?
Well, education was always the biggest component for both of us. I mean, obviously for me, it was, you know, if we didn't have the books right and have the grades right and homework done, like we weren't allowed to go out and practice or play in games or anything like that. And, you know, it was very, very similar with my wife to where, you know, academics was first and foremost for her as well. And, she was also a second grade teacher and it mentioned to me about how important literacy is that for kids by, I think it's third grade, like if they don't know, you know, how to read, by the third grade, you know, their chances of winding up in prison or worse, you know, go up exponentially. So we wanted to do something to just try to kind of help and, you know, and try to kind of do our part to try to provide kids with the opportunity of trying to help them learn, reading by giving them some good, fun books to read and have little situations in there to let them know that like, hey, if you're going through this kind of a situation, you know, you're not the only one. So we wanted to put something out there for the kids.
That's cool. Very cool. I imagine that's been fun sort of diving into a different type of creative process as well and something to share with your family in that regard. Yeah. So a cool experience mm-hmm. as well. You're full of them, man. Like I could talk to you for 2 hours about things that you've done, but I've taken up, I think, more than enough of your time. Ryan, I really do appreciate it. We're proud to have you as a member of the Team USA, USA Baseball family, and wish you well going forward, okay?
Oh, no problem. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Rhino had one of the smoothest left-handed swings of his era, and he's a really interesting guy off the field, so that was a lot of fun. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Thanks, as always, for subscribing, downloading, streaming, all of the above, however you may listen. Next up, with a lot of good nitty-gritty talk about hitting, Nick Lofton, first-round pick to the Royals and Collegiate National Team alum of the Baylor Bears formerly, will be our next guest on Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. But that's in a couple of weeks. In the meantime, stay safe, and we will catch you then.